Welcome back to Unit 11 and the final video in our unit on nuclear chemistry. The marshmallow lab our students performed in the previous video, and that you did on your own, provided you with a fundamental understanding of how fusion works. So now we're ready to apply that knowledge to some real-world examples. To do that, we'll differentiate instruction based on student interest and learning styles, which is just a formal way of saying that you'll get to choose an assignment that plays to your strengths and interests. We're going to develop models to illustrate the changes in the composition of the nucleus of an atom and the energy released in the three processes we've studied: fission, fusion, and radioactive decay. No matter what kind of assignment you choose to complete, all students will develop a diagram or model that compares and contrasts fission and fusion. Some students may choose a task that allows them to demonstrate an application of nuclear chemistry, like a smoke detector, a radiation detector, the medical treatment of tumors, or even how a nuclear power plant generates electricity. Others might choose a task that requires more reading than building, like a project about the history of nuclear technology, or how astronomers have benefited from knowledge gained through nuclear processes. Some students might even want to include original artwork of radioactive decay and fusion. The great thing about a task like this is that you're free to execute the task in a way that matches your natural interests and abilities. Whatever you decide, or whatever task your teacher assigns, you'll have input on how you challenge yourself in this assignment. That said, once you make that choice, be sure to follow the instructions outlined by the teacher on the assignment rubric. Our students have already been reading those instructions that you can find in our Chemistry Matters toolkit. So let's get back to our classroom to see what tasks they've chosen to complete.
I have given you a list of performance tasks. Now you'll need to choose a task from either the Rutherford group, the Becquerel group, or the Curie group. Remember, we're all learning about nuclear fission and fusion, and I've given you several different options from which to choose. So choose the topic that interests you the most, and I'm going to give you a few minutes to review the tasks, and I'll check back in with you in a little while once you've made your decision. Destiny, what performance task seems like the best fit for you?
Well, I like building things, so I thought I might try building a model of a smoke detector. I'm pretty sure I can figure out how to make it with a few key parts and mount them on a display board. Larissa and I talked about working together on this. Is it okay if we work with partners?
Of course you can. You'll both need to follow the requirements on the rubric. So make sure that you include a compare and contrast section on your project board so we can see that you both understand the differences and the similarities between fission and fusion.
I think I can do that based on the notes I've taken in class. We both really like building things. This will be good. I prefer working with a partner too.
I definitely understand. And I know that you've always been interested in building things from the conversations that we had at the start of the semester. And I'll sit down soon with both of you so we can discuss the requirements of the project. What about you, Caleb? What would you like to try?
Epsy and I think we'd like to work together on a performance task about the history of the Manhattan Project. We read about it in our history class, and we figured it would relate to chemistry.
Yeah, that was the secret project during World War II when scientists developed the first atomic weapon.
I like that idea because I saw a movie once about the engineers and scientists who worked in New Mexico to develop the bomb.
And we've got a friend in second period chemistry. You know, Addie? Her uncle works for the Defense Department. Can she join our team too?
Sure. I'll make sure she understands the responsibilities. And I really like the idea of all three of you collaborating on this performance task. You might want to start by writing down what you already know about the project. Then I'll make sure to speak to you later about the specifics of it. How can I help you guys with your project?
I think we have the information we need to compare fission to fusion.
Can we do that as a T-chart with information about fission on one side and fusion on the other?
Yeah, that's a great way to show the contrast. You also want to make sure that you create a list of the similarities between fission and fusion. How about the model that you plan to make? Any thoughts on that yet?
I thought it would work to glue a styrofoam plate onto a poster board to make a shape like a smoke alarm. We can show a box that represents the radiation detector and a box that represents the americium-241.
Then I thought I could use little beads or BBs as alpha particles. I can drop them one at a time from the americium box, showing how they hit the detector.
Right. Then we'll push a piece of cotton into the smoke alarm. That'll represent the smoke. The beads won't be able to get through the cotton, so it'll set off some kind of alarm. Maybe the alarm I have on my phone?
Yeah, that sounds like a great idea. You've both chosen a performance task about the history of the Manhattan Project. Let's look over the requirements of that together. What will you need to accomplish?
We'll need to find some sources of information first.
Yeah, but we really need to decide what kind of information we have to have. I'm sure we can find a general history of the Manhattan Project on the internet or in a book, but who will we write about?
Yeah, how does a nuclear chemistry unit help us understand something so complicated?
For instance, do we include information about the politics, like how the government kept such an important project secret?
Right, but I feel like we need to read a lot more before we can come up with a plan.
Yeah, you're right. It's hard to tackle such a big project without a focus. I can give you a little help with that, I think. Here's a magazine article that gives a really careful outline of the important events that led up to the atomic weapon development. And with Addie's help, you guys should be able to locate enough resources for this project.
As you just saw, our students have developed excellent ideas around this performance task and created solid plans that their teacher approved. After those steps were completed, they followed through on the execution of those plans, doing research, constructing models, and demonstrating to each other how those models would work.
Okay, check out this model of our smoke alarm. We have the box that holds the americium, and the bead represents the beta particles.
That looks cool. So what happens next?
So, when we drop the bead and it hits the radiation detector, the device knows that there's no smoke.
But watch what happens when we put cotton in there to represent the smoke.
When the smoke is in the way, the bead representing the beta particle can't ionize the atoms in the air, so the alarm goes off.
Okay, tell us about your display board.
We took a nuclear chemistry perspective of the Manhattan Project.
Right. We found out that a guy named Enrico Fermi built the very first nuclear reactor in Chicago in 1942.
And it didn't take long for other scientists to find a lot of applications for his technology.
Later that same year, Robert Oppenheimer was appointed the director of the Manhattan Project, a top secret project that took place way out in the desert in Los Alamos, New Mexico.
They worked with both fission and fusion. And within 3 years, they developed a nuclear weapon based off fission.
Our students have shown two real-world applications of nuclear chemistry and are off to a good start refining the presentations they'll be making later to their entire class. But I've got one more real-world application of chemistry I'd like to share. Our team at Chemistry Matters recently visited an isotope laboratory. This is a place where chemists use a combination of radiation detectors and chemical tests to examine samples from soil, water, air, and other sources to measure the levels of radioactive isotopes found in the environment. The workers at this particular lab are especially interested in isotopes that might have been formed by nuclear reactors. This lab can detect alpha, beta, and gamma radiation.
Is the vegetation finished counting yet?
Yes.
And the picocuries per kilogram all came back well below Nuclear Regulatory Commission limits.
Sounds good.
The air, soil, and milk samples all tested below limits as well. They were all below any natural radiation background.
Isotope detection laboratories utilize a wide variety of state-of-the-art equipment for tests like these. This lab even employs a gamma radiation detector that uses liquid nitrogen at a temperature of negative 196 degrees Celsius to cool atoms, reducing their kinetic energy and making any gamma radiation easier to detect. This laboratory also uses qualitative analysis, like we learned about back in Unit 7, to detect the presence of atoms like strontium. because strontium is an element that could also exist in a radioactive form. Just like we do in the classroom, people who work in labs like this take a wide variety of precautions to ensure their safety. For example, the air in this lab is under constant surveillance through the use of environmental dosimeters. But that's not the only precaution they're taking.
We use radioactive sources in our lab for quality control and calibration purposes. Because of this, we wear dosimeter badges to help measure our radiation exposure. We have a laboratory in-house that can read our dosimeter badges as well as the badges for our entire company.
Facilities like this exist around the globe, monitoring a wide range of nuclear isotopes. The purpose of Isotope Labs is to ensure that all nuclear-related facilities are maximizing their security protocols and operating in the safest way possible. We've covered a lot in Unit 11, our unit on nuclear chemistry. We began by refreshing our memories of atomic structure in order to dive into the world of the nucleus, where we discovered some interesting phenomena occurring, like nuclei splitting apart, as observed in our cloud chambers. This process is known as nuclear decay. We then practiced how to write isotope notation for each of the decay products, alpha, beta, and gamma, and how to use them in nuclear equations. We found that we can predict the daughter nuclide of nuclear decay by applying the law of conservation of matter. But we also discovered that matter is sometimes converted directly to energy. And nuclear fission releases a lot of heat energy, while nuclear fusion produces even more energy. Fusion energy is how the sun heats the earth, and it enables life as we know it. We also visited a genuine isotope lab, where chemists test environmental samples, looking for isotopes that could be produced by a nuclear reactor. And our students began project-based learning to solidify their understanding of nuclear chemistry. So this is a good time for you to begin your own performance task with your teacher's guidance, so you'll be ready to make a classroom presentation as well. After that, I hope you'll join me at the top of Unit 12, recapping the content across all of our units and exploring the real-world applications of chemistry. We'll be investigating potential careers that might interest you, and we'll answer any remaining questions regarding the importance of chemistry in our everyday lives. So when you're ready, I'll see you at the top of the Unit 12 playlist.